Now look at the causes of diseases. So generally, if we look at this topic, causes of diseases, if we investigate what are the causes of diseases, so we see that disease is the disturbance in the organ or system of our body. This disturbance may be because of entry of foreign object, any pollutant or anything that enters our body may cause a disturbance. That is one factor. Second thing is pathogens. Pathogens and parasites. If pathogen means a microorganism, either a virus, bacteria, fungi or protozoa. So, if any of these pathogens enter our body, they may cause disturbance to the organ, lead to infection and may cause disease. But these are called as primary causes. So, these two will not give the complete answer for the cause of disease. Because someone may get a doubt that, say there are two babies of an age of some 1 year or 2 years. Two babies. Even though the two babies are exposed to these pathogens, baby A and baby B, if these two are exposed, only baby A gets disease, infection, B is healthy. So why baby A got the disease, if even though they are exposed to pathogen? If we think that the pathogen is the real cause, the microorganism is the real cause of disease, then why don't this baby B did not get a disease? So the second level of causes will let us know. In case of A and B, B is a healthy baby. That means well nourished. Well nourished. What is well nourished? That means the baby B is having good health. The baby B is has given all the nutrients, so she is having a healthy body with all the nutrients, with good resistance, immunity, resistance power in the body. So in case of A, this baby is poorly nutritioned, balanced diet is not given, and the baby A has not taken any balanced diet or nutritious food, so less immunity, this baby A subjected to disease. So nutrition, feeding is the another cause. So baby B may be a wealthy baby, their parents may be wealthy, having enough money and resources to feed the baby all the nutrients. Baby A, poverty, lack of food, so by that poor health. So that is the second cause, poverty and having a not able to nourish properly, that is the secondary cause of a disease. So primary causes here we can think of. So secondary cause is a social cause. So here the factors like proper nutrition or genetic differences, some children genetically they'll be having more immunity, some children genetically they'll be having less immunity. So that is the second cause, secondary cause of diseases. If we look at the another example, there is a baby A and there is a baby B. So baby A is living in poor sanitized conditions, unhygiene conditions, unhygiene. Baby B is living in a clean environment, having drinking boiled water or purified water, uncontaminated water. Baby A is living in a poor environment where there is no proper sanitation and proper drinking water facility. So here also there is a one more social cause, the third level of cause, poverty. So this is also a social cause for the disease. So because of the unhygiene conditions, the virus entered the body of A, the virus not entered the body of B because of living in clean surroundings. So in such a way, of course, these microorganisms or any foreign objects or any chemicals or pollutants, if they are the cause of a disease, they are the primary causes of disease. So these primary causes are not affecting everybody. They are affecting only a few because of that secondary and tertiary causes. So what are the secondary and tertiary causes? The secondary and tertiary causes are the social issues like their food, that poverty, that is unemployment, unhygiene, not having proper sanitation, and some other factors like their immunity, genetical factors, also the other factors which are the cause of diseases, basic causes of diseases. So let us see that infectious and non-infectious diseases. What are infectious diseases? The diseases that spread from one person to another person are called as infectious diseases. They are also called as communicable diseases. So if we look at the infectious diseases, we will see different diseases like cholera, typhoid, TB, and smallpox or chickenpox. So likewise, there is a big list of infectious diseases. What are non-infectious diseases that do not spread from one person to another person? Those are non-infectious. Actually, most of the infectious diseases are caused because of the microorganisms, pathogens. So microbes, they cause these diseases. Whereas non-infectious diseases are caused because of that. We already seen that factor, foreign objects or lifestyle, bad lifestyle. Say because of a bad lifestyle, heart problem may happen, heart attack. So heart attack, that is coronary disease, and high blood pressure, hypertension. So hypertension is a non-infectious disease. It will not spread from person to person. And diabetes or renal calculi, kidney stones. So the kidney stones, why the people get kidney stones? Because of some problems in their diet and false lifestyle habits, not drinking enough amount of water, not allowing the kidneys to purify the salts, waste salts, and all, they are accumulated to form stones, kidney stones. So in such a way, and problems with the liver cirrhosis due to the bad habits like consumption of alcohol because of the smoking habits. So the non-infectious diseases may be caused because of their bad lifestyle, that is bad habits or bad nutrition, or by entry of any foreign objects like foreign particle pollutants, chemicals, toxins, entry of toxins into the body, or accumulation of fat. So obesity, these kind, all these are non-infectious diseases. So the infectious diseases means cholera, typhoid, TB, smallpox, chickenpox, which spread from one person to another person. These are caused by different microbes like virus, bacteria, protozoa, fungi. These are the different kind of microbes which cause the infectious diseases. Now let us see the infectious diseases and disease causing organisms. If we look at the first one, viruses. Virus, they cause viral infections. The virus, it causes diseases like HIV, hepatitis, and a viral fever. And it also causes diseases like polio, etc. So the virus, it may cause cold also. The diseases that are caused by viruses cannot be controlled by using medicines, because viruses, they act like a non-living object when outside our body. When they enter our body, they enter our cells, they use our cell machinery to develop. So controlling these viral infections is a very difficult task by using medicines. So some of that disease is caused by bacteria. Let us see bacteria. Bacterial diseases are cholera, typhoid, TB, that is tuberculosis, diphtheria, and peptic ulcers, etc. are caused by bacteria. So the bacterial infections can be controlled by the uses of antibiotics. So the next one, fungi. Fungi also cause certain diseases like ringworms and other skin infections. Protozoans, they cause malaria, filaria, giardiasis, amoebiasis, etc. So these are all the different types of diseases that are caused by different microorganisms. So there are medicines to cure the diseases caused by microorganisms. First thing is, we can prevent the entry of all these microorganisms into our body by following proper sanitary habits and by maintaining proper cleanliness in our surroundings, personal hygiene as well as community hygiene. But once these organisms enter our body, in case of a bacteria or a fungal or a protozoan, infections can be cured with the help of medicines. Say bacteria, they are unicellular organisms. They protect themselves by their cell wall. So our scientists found how to control their development by destroying their cell walls. So if that medicine is taken, our body cells do not have any cell walls, so that antibiotics will not have any effect on our cells, but they destroy the bacteria. So by knowing the mechanism how they develop, the medicines are invented, which are used to control the diseases caused by bacteria, protozoans and other. But whereas in case of a virus, it is very difficult, because viruses, they do not have any cell apparatus. They use up the apparatus of our cells. But anyhow, nowadays the medicines for viral diseases are also found. Okay, so these are the different microorganisms, viruses, bacteria, fungi and protozoa, which cause the infectious diseases. Means of spread. How do they spread? So we learned that different microorganisms cause infectious diseases. How do they spread? So they spread either by air or by water or by food, contaminated food, or by physical contact. Physical contact. Or by physical contact, or by the objects used by the infectious people. Insects or animals, we call them as vectors. So these are the different means by which the diseases are carried from an infected person to a healthy person. Air, it carries the disease causing germs. When an infected person cough or sneezes, the microorganisms comes out through the respiratory tract, through the droplets, and they are carried by the air to the healthy person. So when some garbage is thrown out, so in the open area, the microorganisms that are grown in the decomposing matter are carried by the air, and they may be carried to some food which is uncovered, exposed to air. So the organisms reach that food, and if the food is eaten by the person, the organisms reach the healthy person and cause a disease. And even water, polluted water, if drainage waste is left into the river waters, carrying many microorganisms. If the human excreta is released into the water bodies like rivers, if the sewage water from the houses is released into the rivers which contain many microbes, so if any organism consumes that water, the infectious diseases are spread. Drinking polluted water causes so many infectious diseases. Sometimes we see, because of the problem with the drainage pipelines, if they are broken in that drinking water pipelines, so the drinking water mixes with the drainage water and it is supplied, leads to many diseases. So water pollutant, water contamination, food contamination. So the food, if it is uncovered, it is exposed to flies, or it is exposed to air and dust, it may be contaminated by microorganisms, and these microorganisms reach the healthy person. And by having physical contact, certain skin diseases, they transfer from the infections, microbes transfer from healthy person to unhealthy person to healthy person. Say for example, if a person has got cold, so when he touches his nose, the germs that cause the cold are stick to his fingers. If he gives shake hand to a healthy person, so the germs are transferred to the hand of a healthy person. Again, if the healthy person, he takes the hand to his nose or mouth, the germs enter the body. So the germs, they take the entry of the body from any source, like through the mouth or through the nose. So in such a way, they cause the disease. So sometimes certain diseases are spread by sexual contact. Diseases like HIV, it is caused by the sexual contact. And many diseases related to the reproductive organs, that is the sex organs, those diseases, reproductive diseases, infections, urinary infections or reproductive infections, are also transferred through the physical contact. Such diseases are called as sexually transmitted diseases. So objects used, if towels, napkins and toothbrushes of an infected person are used by a healthy person, there is a chance of spread of germs from the unhealthy person to healthy person. And in case of insects, insects play a very major role in transfer of germs from one person to another person. Malaria, filaria, dengue, chikungunya, these kind of diseases are transferred from person to person through mosquitoes. Mosquito, when it bites an unhealthy person, the germs enter the body of mosquito. If it bites a healthy person, the germs are transferred to him. At the same time, along with mosquitoes, other insects like houseflies are also an important contributors of spreading diseases. Houseflies, they sit on very unhygiene materials, and again they sit on the food. So contaminating the food, if it is consumed, leads to diseases. So these are the various factors or various means of spread of infectious diseases. Organ specific and tissue specific manifestation. What is manifestation? Manifestation is showing out the result. So when a disease is entered into our body, they reach one particular organ. So the symptoms are shown related to that organ. Say for example, if something enters our nose, we get sneeze immediately. If any microorganisms enter our nostrils or lungs and infected there, so we get some cough or cold. So this cough or cold are the symptoms that are shown by the same system which is affected. So when a disease or an infection takes place in a particular organ, the symptoms, the manifestations come from the same organ. See, if any organism that enters our body, it damages the brain, we get headache or pain related to the particular area. In the same way, if something enters into our stomach and something happens, like a food poisoning takes place inside the stomach, so we get stomach pain, vomitings, motions, which indicates that there is a upset of the particular system. So organ specific and tissue specific manifestations. So on basing the symptoms, the disease will be diagnosed. So if you are getting cough, means you will be diagnosed for the diseases related to the respiratory system. Cough. So if you complained cough, so you will be checked for your lungs. Are your lungs clear? Any phlegm is there? Or any infection is there? So after the finding out that symptoms diagnosis, if it is not found, you will be sent for an X-ray to check your lungs whether they are clear or not. If you complain that you have some pain in your back, so pain in back, then you will be checked for your kidneys, any kidney stones. So if there is any kidney stone, you will get a pain in the back. So you are complaining for a pain in the lower abdomen. Lower abdomen also, kidney stones are stones in the ureters. Ureters. Stones. So depending upon the symptom, the location of the symptom. So depending upon the manifestation, from where you are finding that change, difference, pain. So from there it will be identified that, so that particular system has got. But there is some exemption, like see certain cases like HIV. This virus enters our body through our blood, through our reproductive organs. So it may enter either by blood or by reproductive organs. So it does not affect only the reproductive organs. Even though it reaches the reproductive organs, it is entering throughout the body and it makes the person to lose immunity. All organs will be susceptible to diseases. So that kind of condition is caused by such viruses. But in different cases, to which organ the microorganisms enter, in that organ they will start damaging it. Sometimes in case of a malaria, the parasite enters our liver. It enters into our blood, from blood to liver. From there, it will again damage the blood cells. Such a way, we see that the disease-causing organisms, they reach their target organ. Once they reach their target organ, they start growing in number and they start damaging that part, which results in the outcome of symptoms or signs. So the same method is used by the doctor by observing the signs and symptoms. By doing performing certain tests, he will diagnose the exact cause of the disease. So the tissue specificity of a manifestation, so it will help in the diagnosis. For example, the infection is limited to a particular area. Say for example, infection to the appendicitis. So it will show the inflammation in the lower abdomen, so where the appendicitis is located. In the same way, if you have some kind of infection in your leg or in your hand, so at the site of that infection you will have inflammation. So inflammation means that particular area is affected by the infection. So in that area, because of that defense mechanisms, inflammation is caused. So that is the manifestations. But sometimes it is general, like in case of HIV. So it is shown, that effect is shown in different parts and different systems, and totally the immunity is lost. So the severity of the symptoms or manifestations depends upon the amount of microorganisms that cause the disease. So the infection is caused by less number of microbes, you may not get the symptoms on large scale. So they will be unnoticed sometimes. You may feel like I am tired or there is some problem on day, but you may be recovered out of that, because it depends upon the immunity of our body. So when the disease is caused by a large number of microorganisms, the symptoms will be very high and the severity of the disease is also very high. Principles of treatment. So the first step of the curing the disease is diagnosis. The doctor diagnoses the disease. He will find out what are the responsible organisms for the disease. So then they'll set up the process of treatment. So there are certain principles involved in the process of treatment. So when you visit a doctor, so that you have some infection in your hand or leg, so that infection is caused by some microorganisms. So because of the infection, you have pain, you have inflammation, and you have infection even. So among these three, infection is the disease. Inflammation and pain are the manifestations. Those are the symptoms. So if you go to doctor, He'll give some medicines, prescription. So what is that prescription is for? So the doctor, if they give prescription for pain, painkiller, and if he gives some medicine, which will reduce the inflammation. So reducer of inflammation. So will be the disease cured? So the pain may go. You may not be able to sense the pain because of painkiller. And inflammation also get reduced. But does it mean that the infection is cured? No. So the doctor, he has to give some medicine which will kill the microorganisms that are causing the infection. So when you visit, we visit the doctor. So in the, as the part of their treatment, so they give some medicine to cure the disease. He may give an antibiotic to kill the microbes which are causing the infection. At the same time, he will give some medicines which will reduce the symptoms, because we are suffering from the symptoms like pain and inflammation. So for all this, the medicines are given. So that is the way of treatment. So only by taking medicine for all this, then the disease will be completely cured. So if the medicine is taken for pain and inflammation and infection is ignored, the disease is not cured. So how are these medicines are prepared to cure the infections? We discussed that infections are caused by different organisms like virus. Infection may be caused because of virus, because of bacteria, because of fungi, because of protozoans. Different organisms have different pathways, different structures, and they grow in a different way in our body. So bacteria. So already we discussed that they have a cell wall to protect themselves. As the bacteria are growing inside an organ by causing the disease, so the bacterial walls will be formed for the formation of new bacteria. So certain medicines, they prevent the formation of bacteria wall. So by that, they affect the growth of bacteria and control them. But we discussed that there are no medicines, exact medicines for virus, because the virus metabolisms are entirely different. The viruses, they use their our cells for their activity. If any medicine is prepared to kill the virus, so that medicine may affect our cells because they use our cell machinery. But despite of all these challenges, the scientists have found some medicines to control the viruses. Even to control the very dangerous virus, HIV virus, also certain medicines are discovered. So by knowing the metabolic pathways of different organisms, so the scientists, they have found medicines. So by using of the medicine, the infection will be cured. So anyway, it is a process, curing of a disease. Even you see, sometimes the doctors, along with the antibiotic, along with the painkiller, along with the medicine to reduce inflammation, and along with the antibiotic, they will also give some other supplements which will strengthen your body to make your body resist or fight against the symptoms, against the disease causing organisms. Sometimes B complex tablets also may be given. You need some strength. In some cases, there will not be direct medicine to the disease in case of viral diseases. They'll give some medicines which will kill the bacteria, if any bacteria are involved in causing the disease. And at the same time, they give support to your body cells to fight against the virus. So your natural defense mechanisms are strengthened by some supplements. So that is the way of treatment of a disease. After acquiring the disease, treatment is a very complicated process. In case of chronic disease, the treatment is not ended. It is an everlasting process for a very long time. So, is there any better way? There is cure for many diseases. But instead of taking the curative methods after getting a disease, there is a possibility of preventing the disease. There is a possibility of prevention of diseases. We can protect ourselves from falling under diseases. So that is by taking preventive measures, and the other one is vaccination. So we discussed that prevention is better than cure. So there are possibilities to prevent the entry of a disease causing organism into our body. So what are the different methods of prevention? By following hygiene, community as well as personal hygiene, we can prevent the entry of disease organisms into our bodies. By consuming the boiled water or uncontaminated and safe water, by following certain good healthy habits, food habits, by good lifestyle, we can strengthen our immunity. We can protect our body from harmful effects by following healthy lifestyle, by doing different exercises, or we can maintain our fitness. We can increase the immunity of our body. Such a way we can prevent. So moreover, there is a chance of entry of organisms, even though we take care in all these cases, in hygiene, in case of hygiene or lifestyle or personal physical fitness or whatever. So there we can take help of vaccinations. So the wonderful mechanism, method that helps to prevent the entry of so many diseases, to prevent so many diseases, infection of so many diseases like smallpox, chickenpox, and TB, whooping cough, diphtheria. So likewise, polio, so many diseases. We can get protection from so many diseases, in which mostly included of viral diseases. So for most of the viral diseases, the best method is prevention by vaccination. So vaccination, it was discovered by Edward Jenner. He discovered the process of vaccination. So that vaccination helps us to not fall under the specific disease. Let us see how this vaccination works. So vaccination means it is the disease causing organism which is weakened or attenuated. So the weak organisms are introduced into the body. So these weak organisms, they activate our immune system and make our immune system to learn how to fight against the disease causing organisms when they enter really. So during the process of vaccination, a small amount of weakened germs are introduced into our body. So these weakened germs, they cannot cause the disease. They are in weak state. But what they will do, they will initiate the production of antibodies in our body. So by that, our body will learn how to fight against them. If really we are subjected or we are exposed to such microorganisms, then our body, it has enough store of antibodies and it will kill the microbes, and it sees that our body is not under, our body doesn't fall under that particular disease. So that is the vaccination process. So by the process of vaccination, we activate our immune system and we will make our immune system learn how to fight against a specific disease by introducing the vaccine of that disease. So this vaccination helped a lot of diseases. It kept a lot of diseases under control. Many diseases around polio. So the disease is mostly eradicated. Otherwise, many people would have suffered from polio disease caused by the polio virus. Even smallpox and chickenpox, those diseases were very deadly, life-threatening diseases in olden days before the discovery of these vaccines. But nowadays, the children from the birth, 0 to 5 years of age, there are so many vaccines given which gives protection against a number of diseases. So even there are new vaccines, not only for smallpox, chickenpox, typhoid, tuberculosis. There are so many vaccines for the diseases like for motions, loose motions in children are caused by rotaviruses. Now there are vaccines available for rotaviruses. Now the vaccines are available for hepatitis. They're finding the vaccine even for HIV also. They're finding the vaccine for such viral diseases. So vaccines, they prevent the infection. They prevent the disease. So what are the various factors? That is community hygiene and personal hygiene, good lifestyle, and good nutrition. That is to have a good immune system, good nutrition, and immunization. That is taking the vaccines. So all these help to prevent the infections, or they can prevent the diseases. In this way, one can prevent the diseases and be in the state of health.